bring your pamphlets. Join us in singing our entrance hymn, "Come, Now Is the Time."
Please stand. Solemnly dedicated on Sunday, October 19, 1941, at 10 a.m. Most Reverend Bishop James A. Griffin of Springfield, Illinois, officiated at the dedication ceremonies. Most Reverend Bishop Ojero was celebrant of the solemn pontifical high mass. At noon on Friday, April 30, 1943, Father Clifford E. Meador arrived as the first pastor of St. Peter Parish, which was given parochial status effective May 1, 1943. His congregation numbered 20 families, 18 Italian and 2 non-Italian. The sacrament of confirmation was administered for the first time on September 19, 1943, when Bishop Jero confirmed a class of 20 soldiers and converts from Grenada Airfield and Mackay. First baptism took place on January 11, 1942. When Father Cletus Menon baptized Jacqueline Yvonne Baddes, daughter of St. Stanford, and Violet Baddocks. The first baptism recorded by Father Meadier after St. Peter became parish was on Sunday, October 17, 1943. The first wedding took place on May 10, 1943. The couple married that morning was Arthur Ray Mullings of Corbin, Indiana, a soldier, and Mary Jane Brunet of Brazil, Indiana. Father O'Leary, Father Leo, conducted the first religious vocation school for 1 month with 10 boys, 9 girls, and 1 adult. On July 12, 1990, the Grenada Council, Knights of Columbus, number 10443, was started with 30 members. At present, it holds 73 members. On August 22, 1948, St. Peter Parish was dedicated to the Immaculate Heart of Mary by Father Meadier and parishioners. Catholic Youth Organization formed on October 11, 1950. On May 29, 1965, Samuel J. Messina, son of Mrs. Mary T. Messina and Mr. John B. Messina, received the sacrament of Holy Orders in the chapel of the Pontifical College, Josephinum in Worthington, Ohio. He is the first priest from this parish, and he celebrated his first Mass in this church on Pentecost Sunday, 1965. We are happy to have him here. In 1986, the parish numbered 112 families. At present, we have about 145 families and approximately 300 parishioners. Including Father Martin Ruan, 13 priests have served as pastors and associate pastors. Thus, the occasion of the 75th Jubilee of this church is a special moment to gratefully remember the past, to joyfully celebrate the present, and with prayerful anticipation to embrace the future. As we come together to share our joy, this Eucharistic celebration becomes the core and the center of our celebration. To grace and solemnize this celebration, our Bishop and our Shepherd, Most Reverend Dr. Joseph Kopas, is present with his full cooperation, love and pastoral care. On behalf of our St. Peter Catholic community, I welcome him cordially. I also welcome our Bishop Latino to be among us and pray for us and grace his blessing over all of us. I welcome all the other concelebrants who have come forward to be present physically and share our joy in the celebration. Let us welcome them too. I welcome all the visitors, guests, well-wishers and parishioners. This community of St. Peter Catholic Church takes pride in welcoming you all to share our joy and happiness. Let us pray for one another.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Today we gather joyfully on this feast of Christ the King, the culmination of our church year, and the culmination of the extraordinary Jubilee of Mercy. Always we stand upon God's mercy, flowing from the side of the Lord on the cross, Christ our King. And in his name and his mercy, we prepare worthily to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that my great sin,
in my thoughts,
in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do. Through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. In those days, all the tribes of Israel came to David and Hebron and said, "Here we are, your bone and your flesh. In days past, when Saul was our king, it was you who led the Israelites out and brought them back. And the Lord said to you, you shall shepherd my people Israel, and shall be commander of Israel. When all elders of the Israel came to David in Hebron, King David made an agreement with them there before the Lord, and they anointed him king of Israel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him were created all things in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he himself might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile all things for him, making peace by the blood of his cross through him, whether those on earth or those in heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God. the chosen one. The soldiers also made fun of him, coming forward to offer him their sour wine and saying, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was an inscription over his head, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging in crucifixion blasphemed him, "Aren't you the Messiah? Then save yourself and us." The other one rebuked him, "Have you no fear of God, seeing you are under the same sentence? We deserve it after all. We are only paying the price for what we've done. But this man has done nothing wrong." He then said, "Jesus, remember me when you enter upon your reign." And Jesus replied, "I assure you, this day you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Father Savio was reading from the history in the anniversary booklet, and I had the opportunity during the afternoon to read that. Very, very interesting, the roots and growth of St. Peter's and its connection to the communities, not nearby only, but extending across a good piece of territory in our state. And the question I had as he read the point about the founding families, 17, you know, were Italian. I was thinking, how did those other two families get in here? You know? My half of my heritage is Italian. Calabria, north of Sicily, where Father Sam is, his family originates from, and Bishop Latino. So the history of the diocese in that sense is very fascinating. The founding families and parishes, their growth, and then of course we're Catholic, meaning, as Jesus said, go make disciples of all nations. So many start to come from the surrounding area, and over time we have of course the blessing of such diversity and richness of faith in our parish communities. So we celebrate that today. And on this feast of Christ the King, who came to save all people, we also, again, in the Jubilee year, Pope Francis today closed the holy door, but as we would expect, saying, certainly God's mercy endures forever, but may this symbol of the holy door remind us that we are opening the door to Christ in our lives as our Lord and Savior. So we proclaim him certainly as Lord of the universe, as the second reading from Colossians so eloquently did, but we're claiming him as our personal Lord, as the repentant thief on the cross did, by asking, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." In the history, we have, at the very end, a wonderful reflection, because we can certainly use this in light of who we are as a Catholic people, and what's the essence and the core of our faith in the Lord. And so the history of a parish traces certainly external events, expansions and changes that occurred over the years. However, external developments alone are not an index of progress. External events and activities proceed from and reflect the dynamic spiritual life of people gathered into a Eucharistic community. Through word and sacrament, people of that community share the very life of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. He is the cornerstone and sure foundation of an edifice of spirit, and the people so intimately united with him are the living stones which form that spiritual edifice. They are God's people who offer worship and praise to him at all times. And that's the essence of who we are as we try to imagine the scene of our Lord crucified among the two thieves and all that chaos around the cross of the sneering and jeering and mocking, and yet those who loved him, such as the Blessed Mother and his faithful disciples, curious onlookers. In that moment, we have the encounter, really the first encounter in the promise of paradise in that situation of crucifixion. Remember me when you come in your kingdom. We know that God doesn't forget us. That's our deepest belief in the sense Jesus came to save us. He doesn't forget us. That's why he asked us to remember him at the Eucharist. Do this in memory of me so that you don't forget me. I won't forget you, but you'll get so involved in your lives, you'll forget that I'm here. And so the Eucharist for us is that memory of God made real. And what a joy to celebrate 75 years of this Eucharistic community, proclaiming God's love and mercy. And from the Lord's side on the cross flowed that sacramental life, blood and water, the water of baptism, the blood of our Lord celebrating the Eucharist. So we are very close to the repentant thief in that we too have been promised paradise. But we have more than an hour or a few minutes to live it. We take this life into our families, into our communities. How powerful the merciful love of God is. It's our foundation, our hope. It's a promise. It's our purpose for living, carrying this life in our veins and in our hearts and souls. How powerful. Can the merciful love of God reach the most hardened, jeering criminal? And our scripture today says, yes. That love, in moments where we think it's impossible, nothing is impossible with God. So today, as we consider the people around the Lord on the cross and on the ground looking up, much to learn. Many people are dedicated to those incarcerated in our overcrowded prisons, and they bring this merciful love of the Lord, perhaps to people who have known very little of it in their lives and who have extended perhaps none of it to others. But that merciful love of God can melt that frozen heart and mind and spirit and bring a new life, a promise of eternal life beginning right now. It's interesting, as I read the history, the other group before the cross, the soldiers, who were the baptisms, the first baptisms here in this parish from the Air Force Base during World War II. The soldiers that were in the area while the war continued. And think about in our society today, the need for God's mercy to reach deeply into the hearts and minds of many of our veterans who, because of combat and killing and that kind of violence that leaves an indelible mark, the Lord is needed to bring them back to a peaceful way of life. This past week, one of our gatherings was focused on that at the Bishop's Conference and how we cannot forget veterans often who are homeless, suffering from mental or physical illness, who take their own life. Why? Because this kind of work, as we're hearing of these soldiers at the foot of the cross of the Lord, can be brutal to the spirit. And so in hope we say the mercy of God can touch the hearts and minds of even those people who have experienced so much that is brutal in this world. And that gives us hope for families and for those who accompany them. We also hear about religious leaders at the foot of the cross, jeering the Lord. You know, religious leaders up in, brothers, how are you over there? Religious leaders, and not only ordained, religious laity in the parish, We can forget sometimes that we're all disciples and we're, as St. Augustine said, with you I'm a fellow Christian. As bishop, I lead from the center of the church, but fundamentally, we're all disciples of the Lord. But look what happened in our Lord's time to the religious leaders. They became hardened. They lost that sense of the mercy of God, and religion for them was something to control and kind of distribute at their whim. And our Lord came to break that apart and to say no. More than anyone in a unique sense, religious leaders have to embody this mercy so that others will be drawn to it. And the mercy, of course, is the Lord himself. And then, of course, around the cross were many curious onlookers, those drawn perhaps to their, maybe something daily. You know, we hear of ambulance chasers in our time, where you hear of people getting so enthralled with an accident that another accident occurs on the other side of the road. Well, people are drawn to that kind of spectacle. And those curious onlookers, just wondering what is going on. I think we have a lot of folks like that in our society who kind of look from a distance at the life of the church and the life of faith. And how do we who breathe in the air of materialism, of indifference, of meanness, of paganism in our culture, where everything can be so much in our face that it covers over the spirit, covers over this great gift of God's mercy. Can that mercy break through that in our lives and in the lives of those who might be curious or indifferent? And we're saying yes. That blood and water that flow from the cross is a promise for every person. And the repentant thief gives us that sense that, wow, a little water on arid land and life can spring up at any time. We sang the responsorial psalm, and thank you so beautifully. Father Maddie has said to me when I came one Saturday evening to celebrate Mass, best choir in the diocese, Bishop, right? Yes. They would agree with that, wouldn't they? That joyful responsorial psalm, let us come rejoicing into the house of the Lord. We sang that refrain. And we have today, because it's 75 years of parish life, laying of that cornerstone. And when I first read that, I thought it was dedicated in June and the church was blessed in October. Where are those builders today? 4 months to build the church? I thought that was impressive. But since then, to come into the house of the Lord joyfully on this day, we recount how many people have come into this house joyfully, and we do also today in that spirit of thanksgiving. And that flowed over into the second reading from Colossians. Let us give thanks to God the Father for having drawn us out of darkness into the light and inheritance of his beloved Son. That is thanksgiving, and we give praise to God in that spirit and all of it because we have been embraced by the Lord's loving mercy. And as we build through the Eucharist to its conclusion, remember we say it's through him and in him and with him because all has been created by him and for him. And we are living testimony. We are the living stones that your history speaks of to carry this living and loving mercy of the Lord into our world. And again, we give thanks for this blended and grace-filled opportunity. Together we profess this gift of faith. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord. Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate in the Virgin Mary, and amen. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our Father created a kingdom for us to inherit. We join together as hopeful heirs of that kingdom to pray to him for our brothers and sisters throughout the world.
For our Pope Francis and our Bishop Kopacz and all our priests, Father Savio, and the priests celebrating Mass with us today, we pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For the great nations created through Christ and for him, that they will reconcile their differences and bring peace to the world. We pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For our parish, who in Thanksgiving celebrates our 75th Jubilee, we pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For the future of St. Peter's Catholic Church, that our parish will continue to grow in love and faith to serve the Lord. We pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For those in prison, who despite their faults and failings, are still our brothers in the kingdom, that Christ will bring them to paradise. We pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For all who are contemptuous of Christ, that they may share in the peace of his kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
For our alien, unemployed, titleless brothers and sisters who wonder what all this talk of the kingdom is about. We pray to the Lord.
The Lord hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you have given us your firstborn in whom all life was created. Help us nurture and care for this kingdom we have, the sky, the earth, the waters, our brothers and sisters. In Christ our Lord, we pray.
Amen.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this bread which we now offer to you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this wine, which we now offer to you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
As we offer you, O Lord, the sacrifice by which the human race is reconciled to you, we humbly pray that your Son himself may bestow on all nations the gifts of unity and peace, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you anointed your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the oil of gladness as eternal priest and king of all creation, so that by offering himself on the altar of the cross as a spotless sacrifice to bring us peace, he might accomplish the mysteries of human redemption. In making all created things subject to his rule, he might present to the immensity of your majesty an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one Spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with her spouse, Saint Joseph, and with all the saints, especially Saint Peter, and of whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis of Pope, our Bishop Corpus and Bishop Latino, the order of the bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom, that we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
From the kingdom, the power, and glory of yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Take away the
There are four Eucharistic ministers, four cups, and four communion. Two will be in the center for communion, and the two cups will be the other end, two ends. And the other two cups and communion will be one in the back and one in the top. So you need not rush to that front.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you. We'd like to thank everyone who helped to make our 75th Jubilee a success. We'd like to thank our Most Reverend Joseph Popaz for coming to help celebrate our Eucharist, our pastor, Reverend Savio, all the other celebrants, deacons, and chancellor, our cross bearer, officers, lectors, Knights of Columbus, the Knights of Columbus, our gift bearers, extraordinary ministers, and especially our office secretary, the liturgical team, all the work they did decorating the church, the hall, preparing the mass, our financial team for supplying the money to do it with, our history team for gathering information for our special celebration over the 75 years, our social and food team committee, which we hope our food's going to be good. I've been smelling it all day, I think it is. And we'd like to thank all of our parishioners, visitors, and guests for coming with us tonight. Thank you so much.
Let us pray. Having received the food of immortality, we ask, O Lord, that glorifying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
As the memory of our celebration, the parish would like to give to our most bishop of us.
Beautiful image of St. Peter with the keys. So certainly what a special patron saint, St. Peter, as we ask his intercession always, and all of the saints. So thank you very much. This is a wonderful keepsake and memory for this evening. And I'll have to pray about what corner of the office will be receiving this. But it really is done well, and so thank you very much.
One more little gift for Father Savio is a smaller version that we're going to present him with as remembrance of this celebration.
The first, last, and only the priest of this parish would like to share something with you.
Remembered, or at least it just dawned on me that I was 3 years old when this church was built, born in 38. And this has always been my home parish and still is. And first Catholic school I attended was St. Joseph's Abbey in St. Benedict, Louisiana. So I'm very proud of the parish and glad to see all the faces out there, and I hope to visit with you at the meal. And I keep praying for this parish, and you pray for me. Thank you.
And as we prepare for the final blessing, first we'll ask God's blessing upon the food and drink that await us, and that way after Mass, if there's some, you know, talking while you're not waiting for me to come over to the hall, y'all just start eating, okay? Lord God, we thank you for the food and drink that we will share, continuing this Eucharistic celebration, gathered around the tables lovingly prepared over in the parish hall. We thank you for those who have given of their time and talent and resources to prepare this meal, and we look forward to enjoying it through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord let his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord look upon you kindly and grant you peace.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Let us go in peace and enjoy your love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Solid ground, firm with the fierce is proud and strong. forth from